There's a bright golden haze on the meadow. There's a bright golden haze on the meadow. The corn is as high as an elephant's eye, and it looks like it's climbing clear up to the sky. Oh, what a beautiful morning. Oh, what a beautiful day. I got a beautiful feeling. Everything's going my way.
Good morning, PASW clients, staff, and friends joining us. Welcome to Wednesday's class. I hope you enjoyed yesterday's class with Prentice Prado, the king of the mambo, and all that fun mambo dance stuff. As I said, we're going to be focusing on a musical today, and that was the opening scene. It doesn't get much better than that, that opening scene of What a Beautiful Morning, and we're going to have a beautiful morning today. You like how I put that in there, right? It's going to be a good class, and as you can see, I'm excited about this. We're going to be talking about Rodgers and Hammerstein's Oklahoma. Talked about Rodgers and Hammerstein before, with John's favorite musical, The Sound of Music. Wink, wink. That was their last collaboration. Now we're going to go to their first. So, lest anyone think it's a corny cowboy show, here's why Oklahoma's important. Just as starting off, before we get into the details of it, it's one of the first book musicals. Okay, now stay with me. Where it's a musical play where the songs and dances are completely integrated into a well-made story, okay, with serious dramatic components. Whereas musicals before Oklahoma, before 1943, because that's when it came out, were kind of these silly gags. It was just kind of these big songs that would focus the songs and the singers with kind of, you know, dumb little storylines and then, you know, pratfalls and stuff like that. You know, I mean, that's fun, but this Oklahoma, Rodgers and Hammerstein took it to a little bit, elevated it to a little bit more serious level in the sense of it wasn't just a silly story. The songs and the lyrics and the choreography all came together in a way to make it a real film and not just something that was kind of silly or immature, you know. So that's why we're talking about it, because it was innovative, because it was one of the first real stories with music and dance that were all incorporated together evenly and not as a joke. So, having said that, let's talk about Oklahoma. So we'll get to several factors of this, but I guess we'll start at the beginning. As I said, this was their first collaboration, Rodgers and Hammerstein. And it so in the early 40s they start collaborating on this thing because Rodgers is broken up with his lyric writing partner Lawrence Hart because of some health issues, and Lawrence Hart was one to write music after Rodgers had written the full song, and with Hammerstein it was the opposite. Hammerstein would go by himself and write the lyrics with no music. And Rodgers would write the song without any lyrics. So this was how their partnership happened, and this was a perfect marriage. And I think because of Hammerstein's way of writing lyrics this way, they would stand on their own, the lyrics, in the sense of, let me hear the song and then I'll get inspired. And that was Lawrence Hart approach. And it was very successful because he was a great lyricist. But I think with Hammerstein, it developed into a little bit more literary importance where it's like a poem. The poem stands on its own, or the stanza, the story. And then set with music, it just becomes completely... it's elevated to a more sophisticated level. So that's how their working style was boring.
Chicks and ducks and geese better scurry when I take you out in the Surrey. When I take you out in the Surrey with the fringe on top. Watch that fringe and see how it flutters when I drive them high-stepping strutters. Nosy pokes will peek through the shutters and their eyes will pop. The wheels are yellow, the upholstery's brown, the dashboard's genuine leather. With eyes and glass curtains, you can roll right down in case there's a change in the weather. Two bright side lights winking and blinking. Ain't no finer rig, I'm a-thinking. You can keep your rig if you're thinking that I'd care to swap for that shiny little Surrey with the fringe on the top.
So Rodgers and Hammerstein are both interested in this story, kind of separately without knowing that they were interested in this story, Green Grow the Lilacs. And that was the basis of the story for them venturing off into Oklahoma. Now, when you think of, we like to think of influences, right? Of usually when we have something, it comes from something else. We're all influenced by art. And so with Richard Rodgers, and we'll hear about in some of this music, he was very influenced by a quote-unquote serious composer, Aaron Copland. Aaron Copland comes out with this ballet about a year before, 1942, that has the very famous song Rodeo in it. And Richard Rodgers went to go see this and was very influenced by Copland's Open Prairie, where it's, you could, and what I mean by that is like when you hear the music, you, it, without seeing it, you, it evokes something where it's like, yeah, this does sound American and open prairie like, and you know, you can almost visualize it. So Rodgers said that the open air spirits of Oklahoma had much in common with Copland's Open Prairie. And if you listen to this is Copland's music. It sounds a little bit musical theater-like, and from a classically trained composer, Copland was getting into film music and musical theater a little bit, but didn't really go that deep into it. Kind of remained a more of a serious classical composer, and was a mentor to Leonard Bernstein, as we talked about earlier. So that's Rodgers' influence, a little bit, of using Copland's Rodeo. And they start, Rodgers and Hammerstein start to getting ready for Broadway, and this is 1943, and they open at the Schubert off Broadway, because that's what you do. You don't open on Broadway. You don't get to Broadway till it's tweaked and perfect and tried out in places like Boston and places like that. And it wasn't really a huge hit right before Broadway, and two things made it important. So before it was called Oklahoma, it was called Away We Go. Now, when it, they made some changes before they went to Broadway. They included a song in it called Oklahoma, and they renamed the musical Oklahoma. And with those two tweaks, it became hugely successful on Broadway. So it was almost like they needed a hit song, you know, and it played forever on Broadway. And in 44, the year after, Rodgers and Hammerstein wrote it, they won a Pulitzer Prize for it. So 12 years later, they decide to do a film version of it, which directed by Fred Zinnemann. And it's the best version. I mean, they wanted James Dean as Curly, and they played with casting a lot. But they cast two great, brilliant people, Gordon McRae and then Shirley Jones in her first role. And just, these are all their real voices. It just came alive so beautifully.
Don't throw the
both Rodgers and Hammerstein oversaw the film version to prevent the studio from making any kind of changes. So they were very heavily involved, which is probably why it was so good. And the movie was filmed with very little camera movement. So it kind of looks like you're, it gives you the Broadway feel and looks like you're almost watching the play. But also the little movement, like we talked about with the Master Shot class, it makes you feel like you're in the moment with those billowing clouds and like you're in Oklahoma. Now, granted, they shot this in Arizona, not Oklahoma, but nonetheless, it's still beautiful.
Everything's up to date in Kansas City. They've gone about as far as they can go. They got a big theater they call a Burlicue. For 50 cents you could see a dandy show.
Gal?
One of the gals is fat and pink and pretty.
Uh-huh.
Round above as she was round below. I could swear that she was padded from her shoulder to her heel. And then she started dancing, and her dancing made me feel that every single thing she had was absolutely real. She went about as far as she could go.
Yes, sir, she went about as far as she could go.
And it was also the first feature film photographed in 70mm widescreen. So that's pretty cool. Not just the first musical, but the first feature movie shot in 70mm widescreen.
I'm just a girl who can't say no. I'm in a terrible fix. I always say, come on, let's go. Just when I ought to say nix. When a person tries to kiss a girl, I know she ought to give his face a smack. But as soon as someone kisses me, I somehow sort of want to kiss him back.
Now, one of the things that always, and I've talked about this with West Side Story, that always is so important to me is, yes, you need a great song and, you know, great lyrics with musical, but it's the arrangements. For me, the arrangements are almost just as important. And Richard Rodgers didn't do his arrangements. Bernstein did, but most composers, Jerome Kern, other people, they were songwriters. They probably could do them, but I think that they knew that somebody could do it better, you know? And that person is Robert Russell Bennett, and he was so influential and really the founder of the Broadway sound, and actually wrote a book called The Broadway Sound, and he was really responsible for elevating the status of the theater orchestrator. And he worked with Cole Porter, Jerome Kern, Gershwin, Irving Berlin, Frederick Lowe. He was their guy when it came to making their music sound brilliant and great. I mean, brilliant, clever arrangements. Just and used the orchestra so in such a clever. He knew how to do comedy. He knew how to do dramatic, serious string stuff. Now, he was classically trained, and he studied with Nadia Boulanger, who's one of the most famous composition teachers in the world. She was. And Aaron Copland studied with her, and Leonard Bernstein studied with her, and Philip Glass studied with her. A lot of people that we've talked about studied with her. So Robert Russell Bennett, although he was a composer in his own right, one of the best orchestrators of all time. And Richard Rodgers said, "I give him credit with undue modesty for making my music sound better than it was." So what a compliment. I mean, and he went on to orchestrate Showboat, Annie Get Your Gun, King and I, South Pacific, Sound of Music, Camelot. I mean, when you hear those scores, that's Robert Russell Bennett. So I think he deserves a little shout out there, because without those wonderful arrangements, they would still be fun songs. But now with arrangements and good songs, you have that combination that's just unbeatable.
With me, it's all or nothing. Is it all or nothing with you? It can't be in between. It can't be now and then. No half and half romance will do.
I'm a one woman. So I hope you enjoyed the class on Rodgers and Hammerstein's Oklahoma. It's one of my favorites. It's important because it broke the new rules. It invented a new formula. You know, it was a play with music, and a musical play in the sense that it wasn't just, you know, this thinly plotted kind of corny thing with jokes and all these kind of, you know, it took itself seriously, and it was one of the first to do that. Obviously, when I say that now, it's not really that new, but it was for 1943. They weren't doing serious drama with music. It was either drama or musicals, and Oklahoma was one of the first to combine both of those dramatic elements with good acting and good dialogue and good storytelling and real emotion with songs that were, you know, I mean, just the Dream Ballet sequence is like 15 minutes long. Now, I'd always fast forward to that as a kid because it was kind of boring, but when you think of that, that was really out there to do that, and that choreography was expressing, that scene's expressing Laurie's problem with which man to choose. And so we're seeing her kind of as her dreaming thoughts, we're seeing that. That was kind of iconic back then, and a little bit avant-garde back then to go into, you know, Freudian sleep and having this beautiful ballet by choreographed by Agnes DeMille. It was a little bit out there, but it worked, and it was beautiful, and it wasn't done in ballet before. Agnes DeMille actually choreographed the Copeland's rodeo, so I'm sure Rodgers wanted to grab her and say, come to and work with our musical, and she really helped transform the American musical theater of the 40s and 50s. I mean, and in the way of integrating choreography with the story, using the story and the choreography to tell a story. So I love Oklahoma. I hope you guys enjoyed that. Even if you don't enjoy it, you know about it, and that's why I'm here, and that's why we're here, to learn more about these things. So what a beautiful morning this was. Yeah, okay, I've said it all. Love you guys so much, and miss you. We'll be back, you know, I'll be here tomorrow talking about something else. I have some ideas. It's going to be good. Okay, all right, have a good rest of the day.